All right, music lovers, are you ready for part four of Flying Home with Lionel Hampton? We're flying through, actually, not the complete discography, because I don't own his complete discography. As I've said many times since the beginning of these episodes, Lionel has got a huge discography. To collect them all would be quite a challenge, in my opinion. But this will be part four of our musical biography, if you want, and survey of some of the most essential works, or essential recordings throughout his career of the great Lionel Hampton. Recordings which I'm trying to present in a chronological order. Now, the last episode, we were pretty much in 1953. I played some extracts from the great 5-CD set that was released. I was looking for the title. Here's the title if you're looking for that 5-CD set. Regrouping, it's called, here's the title of it, The Complete Lionel Hampton Quartet and Quintet Recordings with Oscar Peterson. These are all recordings made between 1951 and 1954, reissued on a 5-CD Verve record set. So once again, that title is The Complete Lionel Hampton Quartet and Quintet Recordings with Oscar Peterson. Early 50s recording between 51 and 54. Now we played that fundamental track that was going to become one of the great numbers of Lionel Hampton, Stardust. And before I go any further and we start up with the year 1954, with a recording from 1954, I just want to ask you to go ahead and comment down below, leave me some comments, subscribe to this channel if you like these little musical profiles that I'm sharing with you. I'm sharing a lot of music, a lot of audio extracts, because what I'd like to do is, of course, turn some people on to jazz and some of the greatest jazz artists ever. So this is part of an ongoing series I've got an idea of doing on different giants of jazz and profiling them musically, chronologically, and letting you hear different extracts of their musical productions at different periods of their career, so you get an overall glimpse at the whole body of work that these people have produced over time. And most of the great jazz giants have had very long careers. If you look at Count Basie, if you look at Duke Ellington, look at this man we're looking at right now, Lionel Hampton. So this should help us get all through the coronavirus pandemic, if ever there's an out to this. Sometimes I'm starting to wonder. But anyway, so go ahead and subscribe, leave some comments, put up a couple of likes, share. Feel free to share this video with anybody you want on the internet, and we're going to move on. So we're going to start up now our first musical extract. Again, we're in 1954. Now, last time in the last episode, I also played a piece that was recorded during Lionel's first European tour, where he stopped off in Paris at l'École de Musique de Paris, and he actually performed live for a music school, and was recorded in 1953 in France. And he's going to have quite a love affair with France, because he's going to be there almost every year throughout the 50s. He's going to go back to France right into the 60s. He's going to be going there regularly. He's going to record extensively over there on different music labels, record labels in France. So there's a lot of recorded output out there on French labels in France for Lionel Hampton collectors to look for anyway. So they're not necessarily easy to find, although some of them have been reissued, put out on CD, and probably on record, long playing record also. But so we're now in 1953, his first trip. 1954, he goes back. He has a concert at the Apollo Hall in France, not to be confused with the Apollo Theater in New York, in Harlem. This is the Apollo Hall in France in 1954. And he, again, as I said many times, Lionel can really create quite an atmosphere. And so just to give you an example of the atmosphere here, here's his last number on that concert date of 1954 at Apollo Hall in France. Here's Flying Home, halfway through anyway. Well, we're at the saxophone solo by one of his band members. Here it is. ¶¶
to note here is that these performances, they're getting more and more, they're getting wilder and wilder by the performance, okay? Lionel and his big band, they'll create an atmosphere, an electric atmosphere, a supercharged atmosphere, and people will go nuts. And as I said, often chairs start flying, people get up on tables, they start jumping around back and forth, all kinds of things happen during a Lionel Hampton performance. It's incredible, you know, he generates enormous amount of energy and he really plays the crowd as much as his big band. And so in this second tour of Europe and a recording that was done in Paris in 1954, he's really creating an atmosphere again, and the people in Paris will just love him for it, and they will be going to these concerts every time Lionel is in town. He doesn't have difficulty drawing a crowd in Paris anyway. And this crowd here on this recording, you can hear already that the crowd is supercharged and screaming. It's like we're at a rock concert, really. And this again, we're still before the rock era. Rock era starts and rock and roll starts in 1956. This is recorded in 1954. But you listen to the reaction of the crowd at the end of this number, and you'll see what I mean. And Hampton will address the crowd and give them a couple of thank yous at the end. But this is what I mean by the creation of this incredible electric atmosphere. This is a good example of it. Big band members. So who we're hearing here, I don't know exactly who's taking the saxophone solo, but the band here is Lionel Hampton on vibraphone, Jay Peters on tenor sax, Jay Dennis on alto sax, Robert Platter on alto sax, flute and clarinet, Elvin Fraser's on tenor sax, Joe Evans on baritone sax, Wallen Davenport, Julius Brooks are on trumpets, Edward Mullins, Dwight Mitchell are on piano, and Peter Brady's on bass, and Wilford Edelton is on drums. And just, here it is, the ending. And listen to the crowd. Rock concert. You think you're at a rock concert with this kind of overwhelming response. Here's Lionel Hal addressing them.
May we say sincerely for the whole gang and myself, we want to thank you a million for those kind of applause. We hope you will see you the next time you come around. But right now, may we say good luck, thank you friends very much.
So anyway, this little extract here gives you an example. Just listen to that crowd. It gives us an example in 1954 of where Lionel Hampton was at with his popularity and the kind of atmosphere that he could create with his big band, which was absolutely amazing, incredible, electrifying stuff. As I say, there's many examples of this over throughout the 50s and into the 60s in the United States also, not just in France, of course. He would create an uproar just about everywhere he went because of his showmanship. Lionel was an incredible showman and an all-around entertainer. You know, these guys that can do it all, you know, just they really...
they not only work with their band and their fellow musicians, but they also work with the public. They create an energy. They transmit this energy to the public. And Lionel had this. He was very charismatic on the stage. He was a very, very much passionate about his playing, passionate about his musicianship and about his music. And he transferred this over. It moved over to the crowd. So anyway, this is 1954 during his second European tour. He's going to be back in the States in 1955. What's going to happen in 1955? He's going to be working, amongst other things, on the Benny Goodman story, the Universal picture that's made as a sort of a bio-romanced biopic of Benny Goodman. It's got all the dates wrong. All the chronology is wrong in that movie. It's terrible from a point of view of facts. It's really just one of those cheesy movies from the 50s. All the musicians, though, in that movie are real. So Hampton appears in that movie, along with Gene Krupa, along with Teddy Wilson, along with Harry James. Many of the real musicians that were working with Benny appear, except Benny. He doesn't appear in the picture because his role is played by Steve Allen. So, but while Hampton is working on that movie and he appears in that movie, he will record part of the soundtrack. So all the quartets, there's two quartet numbers included in the soundtrack. And so Hampton will be reunited with Gene Krupa, Teddy Wilson, and Benny Goodman, and will record for that motion picture soundtrack. He'll also, at the same time that's going on, since he's reunited with his old quartet partners from the 30s, he's going to make another separate album on the side with Gene Krupa and Teddy Wilson alone. And it's going to be a trio album called Krupa, Wilson, and Hamp. He's also going to do, in 1955, he's going to record with the great Stan Getz. He's going to do an album called Hamp Meets Getz. And so Getz is more of a cool jazz kind of guy. So that's different for Hampton, and he being, of course, of the old swing school. But that's one thing about Lionel. He's from the old swing school. He's a swing school master. But he does not shy away from other musical genres within jazz and even outside of jazz. Later on in his career, he'll do some stuff. He'll even record some disco stuff. He'll do all kinds of stuff. But here he is with the cool jazz master, Stan Getz, was starting to make a name for himself back then in 55. His career had just really begun about 6 years earlier in 1948-49. But here he is recording with him in 1955 from the album Getz and Hamp. Here is an extract of Gladys. Get an idea of the wonderful sound, the wonderful virtuosity that Hampton has attained at this part of his career. By 1955, the vibes hold no secret for him anymore. He can do pretty much what he wants on there, and he will illustrate it many times over on many, many, many recordings. So he's recording with Stan Getz. He's going to record with a lot of jazz greats during the 50s and 60s. In 1955, though, while he's back in France again, He's going to go and record an album, actually, that's been put out on a 2-CD set on the Gitane Jazz label, which is part of the Verve Music Group, I believe. He's going to record an album just to title, they put it out, they issued it out, called Jazz in Paris, and it's called Lionel Hampton and His French New Sound. Volume 1 and Volume 2 have been put out, as I say, on a 2-CD set on the French Gitane Jazz label. Part of the Universal Music Group, and he's going to go in France, so he's back in the studios, this time in France, and he's going to record some stuff, and he's going to record many things. He's going to record for Vogue Records, also a French record label, for Musidisc, also in the early 70s. He's going to really do a lot of recordings for those French labels. I don't know how many exactly he made, because some of those things are hard to find here in the North American side. I think the French people over there, if any French people are watching this show and you know of the output that exists out there in France from Lionel Hampton on record, please let me know. Write me a comment in the comment section below, and why don't you subscribe while you're at it. And yeah. Let me know what's available out there. I know there's a lot out there, and I only know of a few recordings. There's a few in my collection here that I'm going to share, but I know he did a lot. So in 55, he's back, he's there, he's in the studios in Paris once again, and he records this album called Lionel Hampton and His French New Sound. Now, I don't know how new the sound is, but it's pretty refreshing for what he was doing. In the time, we're going to hear a little extract from that called Crazy Rhythm. So this is from the album Lionel Hampton and His French New Sound, recorded in Paris, 1955. Crazy Rhythm, taken from the album Lionel Hampton and His French New Sound, recorded in 1955 in Paris and put out under the Gitane Jazz record label. And this was one of the many recordings he was to do in France on a number of years throughout the years, stretching right into the 70s, maybe even into the 80s. I'm not sure if he recorded more in France in the 80s. Now, there, this period near the end of the 50s, he's also, we're in the mid 50s right now, but by the end of the 50s, he's going to found his own record label called Glad Hemp Records, which will continue. He'll keep going probably till the end, pretty much till the end of his career. Although the output is infrequent and unequal, you know, he's going to put a lot of stuff out in the late 50s, early 60s on his Glad Hemp Records. He's got, of course, a lot of his recordings, his live recordings, where he records himself more or less in his big band, and so he has a lot of latitude there to record, of course, himself, and to release these recordings on his own record label. And it's going to keep on functioning for a long, long time, because as I've got a Glad Hemp record dating from 1988, recording from 1988, so he's been around, his label was around for a long time, and he's issued a lot of his own recordings on this, and probably some other jazz artists too, although I never saw any of them, any other jazz artists on the Glad Hemp Records label. So if you know anything about that, let me know. I know he was issuing his own stuff on Glad Hemp, but was it just for that, or was it also sometimes issuing other musicians, other jazzmen on that? I'm not sure. He's going to also found another label called the Who's Who Jazz Label, where he's going to feature a lot of Who's Who in jazz. That's during the 70s, but we'll be back. We'll discuss that later once we're down during that period. But right now, getting back to 1955. So this recording is done in France again. And then again, he's going to go back to France in 1956 and do some more recording in 1956 in France. He's going to be recording this time. It's called the Paris Jazz Session. This is a CD that was issued called Paris Jazz Session. It was recorded in 1956. The musicians this time, he's going to be featuring some French musicians on these recordings. Here's the musicians that he's featuring on this one, the Paris Jazz Session. This is the next extract I'm going to play here. He's got, of course, he's on the vibraphones. He's got Guy Lafitte, the great French tenor sax man, on tenor sax. He's got the tremendous Claude Bolling, who just passed away recently, I believe, not too long ago, on piano. He's got his faithful guitarist, who was to stay with him for a very, very long time during his career, the great Billy Mackles on guitar. Paul Revere is on bass, and Curly Hamner is on drums. And this was recorded in Paris at the Studio Magellan in May of 1956. And what does it sound like? Well, here's a glimpse of what that sounds like. We're going to hear Panama, recorded in 1956, Paris Jazz Session. Lionel Hampton and his some of his Paris musicians, or French musicians anyway. Here he is. Here's Panama. Wonderful sound take on this recording. Absolutely beautiful sound take. The French knew how to record, I'll tell you something. Usually, French recordings are very high quality, fidelity-wise. Album. It's written here, in 1956, Lionel Hampton records were already numerous. Today, they are almost countless. Imagine, by 1956, somebody could write this. He could actually say that in 1956, Lionel Hampton's were already numerous, and today, well, of course, that's later when he's writing these liner notes, that's true, they are countless. But already in 1956, they were numerous. So he was very much a very, very recorded jazz musician. And he says here, yet at no time does the present album seem over familiar. No doubt because Hamp, at his peak, has always been a great catalyst, a superbly inventive musician. Black or white, American or European, all succumb to his drive and inspiration. four words sum it up nicely: the miracle of jazz. So yes, this is a wonderful, wonderful album. There's Billy Mackle playing some great guitar. So that's 1956. That's 1956, and coming back to the United States after this stint again in France, he's going to record some more throughout the 50s. Now, in my personal collection, which I'm sharing with you here, I've got a whole 1957, I don't have anything, 1958, I don't have anything. I'm sure he recorded, though, because he's not without recording for a long time. So I'd be surprised. I'd have to check his discography, but I'm pretty sure he's got some issues. Some records are being issued during those 2 years. My next album that I want to share with you here is an album recorded for RCA in 1959. He recorded two albums called Silver Vibes and Golden Vibes. Wonderful, wonderful albums. And just a beautiful, he plays mostly ballads on these two albums. I can't recommend it enough. These are beautiful, luscious arrangements. He's backed by a great trombone section. We're going to hear that trombone session section backing him up here on an arrangement of Speak Low, recorded on the album Silver Vibes in 1959. So this is what you could hear in 1959 from the great Lionel Hampton. This was recorded on RCA Records. Again, showing us how he could be very, very smooth and laid back on the vibraphones, have this beautiful velvety touch to him if he wanted to. So just a wonderful, relaxed album, highly recommended. Silver Vibes and Golden Vibes, two albums put out on RCA in 1959. Now, when we leave 1959, again in 1960, I've got nothing, I've got a hole in my collection, so I can't share anything from 1960. I have to go back right after that to 1961. Where again, this tremendous album is put out in 1961. It's the Lionel Hampton Big Band recorded live in Paris. He's back in Paris again, back with his Parisian audience, and he's gonna create another one of those crazy uproar reactions in Paris. And if you wanna get an idea of the kind of incredible audience frenzy that existed for him, just listen to this, an extract of this two record set on Musidisc, the French record label Musidisc. This is Lionel Hampton live in Paris in 1961 at the Olympia in Paris. And listen to the reaction of the crowd when he goes into a groove on this number called Paulette's Boogie. So here's a little extract just to let you know, give you an idea of the atmosphere that Hampton and the electricity that he could really, really create. There he goes.
crowd goes wild as Hampton goes into one of his boogie numbers. And you can hear the response, just the over-enthusiastic response of the Parisian audience cheering like mad in the background. And you hear them cheering all the time here during all the numbers that he does. They're just screaming and hollering. You'd swear you're at a rock and roll concert. That's how great of a cheer and of an audience reaction the great Lionel Hampton can get from the people who are watching him. He's an electrifying performer. Just incredible stuff. These recordings testify to that. And there's many more in his career that testify to that. So that's again in 1961. And we're reaching the 30-minute mark. I'm going to have to end this program soon. I'm going to try and play one last number. 1964 is my next number I've got queued up. It's called Ring Them Bells. And it's from a landmark album recorded on Impulse Records. The great Lionel Hampton reunites with some of his old buddies, most of them from the Swinger, all of them from the Swinger, actually, without a doubt. This is a tremendous, tremendous album where he sings and plays the vibes. Good time train is leaving. And revisits a lot of his own old numbers that he recorded in small group form during the 1937-1941 era. So we got Lionel Hampton here on vibes, Clark Terry's on the trumpet, Ben Webster is on tenor saxophone, Hank Jones on the piano, Milt Hinton at the bass, and Ozzie Johnson on drums. And this is a gem of a record. Wonderful recording, 1964, called You Better Know It on the Impulse record label. Ring them bells. Now, if you listen to this music and you don't dig it, I don't know, man. I don't understand. I listen to this. The great Ben Webster. How can you not dig that? So I'm going to leave you on this note, on this recording. We're down to 1964 now in the career of Lionel Hampton and this musical biography I'm trying to sketch and paint of the great Lionel Hampton. So, once again, I'm going to leave you on these last notes and ask you to subscribe, leave some comments below, share the video with other people if you think might be interested in these little musical biography surveys that I'm doing of great jazz giants. More to come. This is part 4 on the great Lionel Hampton. I'll be back with part 5 in the future, the next episode. So until then, put up some likes, subscribe to the station, and I'll see you later in the next episode. Until then, don't forget, jazz on, everybody. Jazz on.